Thanks to everyone for coming this afternoon. My name is Dr. Kyle Treiber. I am the Deputy Director of the Peterborough Adolescent Young Adult Development Study, and so I work very closely with Professor Wickstrom on developing SAT, and I'm very delighted to be able to chair this panel today. We have a group of practitioners from Denmark who have been applying the concepts of situational action theory in their municipality. We've had quite an ongoing, long-term relationship with these individuals, lots of communication and collaboration with them about SAT, and we're very excited that they have been putting it into practice. So they're really the pioneers of putting SAT on the ground and seeing what is coming out of it. So with no further ado, I will introduce our first speaker. The session is called Who Conducts the Orchestra? And that is also the title of our first paper. So I'll introduce Hella Mitzkoff-Bruno. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
May I also ask, apologies, that we save questions to the very end, because all of the papers will have a similar theme, and so we'll have questions at the very end. Thank you.
Yes, but I will conduct this orchestra in 1.5 hours here. Welcome. I will tell you about a large project about crime prevention that has been carried out in the municipality of Vejle. This project have carried out within SSP. SSP is a cooperation between school, police, and municipality authorities, social workers. In 2010, the Danish government demanded all Danish municipalities to work out a crime prevention strategy based on a common police of children and youth. This is the strategy. And you can see it here after, if you like. The life of 6 young individuals were investigated from the day they were born. We invited the individuals, their parents and families, their schools, the reformatory schools, as well as the environment where they grow up. All these interviews showed us the gaps in the previous effort and where we could improve our crime prevention strategy. This has now become our 6-point strategy. As you can see from this slide, the 6 points include the following. Relation do make a difference. Early parents' involvement. Preventing young people from skipping school. Target effort on hazard abuse. The world awaiting. Better cooperation regarding vulnerable young people. Better interaction across department. I do not have time to go to the 6 point now, but feel free to come and speak to me after the presentation. Who conducts the orchestra takes a primary effort in focus point 3, preventing young people from skipping school, because we know that school attendance is vital in the effort of preventing of our youth to start a criminal career. In 2012, when I wrote our criminal prevention strategy, I met Professor Per Olof Wikström, who came to Denmark to speak about situational action theory. At this time, I was studying criminology at the University of Aarhus. Here, I realized that Wikström's approach was the first time somebody has approached the understanding of crime backwards. Because Professor Wikström doesn't talk about why you become criminal, but instead why most people, more than 55%, doesn't become criminal. I will shortly tell you about the ideas that got me interested in Professor Wikström's 20 years worth of research. I have a great respect for his work and much apologize that I have to simplify his work due to the short time I have in my presentation. The first time I heard Professor Wikström present situational action theory, he explained it in the following way. He met several young people and asked, if you see an open cabriolet on the street with a purse, key and a telephone, why don't you just take it? To this, all the young people answered, because I could lose the relation to my family and friends if I commit a crime. The next thing they said was, that the moral and education they got at home meant that they didn't think that they could take something that belongs to somebody else. This shows that the moral that has come through throughout one's upbringing has an existential influence, you will end up with a crime or not. So moral is very important. The final thing they said was, the self-control I have learned shows me that I might be tempted, but I can control myself. The newest research shows that if children learn self-control before they turn 7 years, they will do better in life. Self-control is used in school, in space time, and later at work. The last thing Wikstrom point out in that is that the environment we grow up in is important for not becoming a criminal. When teenagers distance themselves from their parents and the outside environment plays a large part in the behavior. It is seen that children and teenagers that have grown up with good relation to their family and friends with a high level of moral and self-control become more situation resistant, and hereby they will be easier to communicate with later in life. Let me first give you an overview of the key steps and factors in the perception choice process. Professor Wikstrom's theory explains how choices are made when you are motivated by something. My son studies economics at the university. When he achieved a top grade in one of his last examinations, he was asked by two other students if he wanted to earn 8,000 kroner by doing the examination for them. The two other students only had one chance left to pass the examination and hereby also their degrees. The examination could be done at home on the computer, so nobody would know if they had cheated. The motivation to earn 8,000 kroner was great, especially for a student. However, my son's moral filter, as you can see up there, the moral filter here. However, my son's moral filter resulted in him in worrying. What happens if somebody finds out if I'll never get my education? And whatever if we later will become college? He knew that this was not an opposition. So therefore, his moral filter told him crime is not an alternative and there will be no crime. If he had thought, I have done this before, I can do it for the money, then it will have been a crime act. So he will go these steps. If his moral filter had not come into play, arguments about the risk of being found out would have had an influence on whether or not this would be a criminal act. The model shows that when something motivates us and when we want to act upon our motivation, and continuous scan takes place in our moral filter, which has our values, moral relations and self-control and environment as a base. These factors will then decide which action will be carried out based on our motivation. Another point highlighted by Wikstrom is that people will break the rule if they do not agree with the rules, they do not care about the rules, if there are no consequences breaking the rules. We do certain things because we can, like downloading music, for example. As we can see in the picture, if there is no one to infer the rules, people will break them. Wikstrom talk about causes of causes, because people do not steal a soda because they're thirsty, but it is the indirect causes that make someone choose to steal or not to steal. Wikstrom included psychology into crime prevention work. It is essential what upbringing someone has had and how good the parents have been at creating relation, teaching self-control, and how good the environment has been to grow up in. And the causes of the causes are exactly what makes the cognitive psychology an important part of situational action theory. The inputs we have are exchanged in our brains and the prerequisites to understand, exchange, and convert input into outputs are associated with the cognitive prerequisites. And in particular, our conductors who conduct the cognitive orchestra. Causes of causes, so the hand that have held or not held us throughout our upbringing are essential for demerging if we get a life where we are connected or disconnected to the society. The causes of wherever we end up in crime, gangs or radicalizations is closely connected to the environment we have grown up in, the relation we have had with our parents, the upbringing we have had, and the self-control we have been through. If children and young people do not have the prerequisites, some communication will not succeed when they turn 16 years old, as they might have been disconnected from the normal society. The young people who get the hardest punishment are the young people where there have been a low involvement of parents' ability and responsibility. And therefore, it's very important that you have parents or a mentor to help you. Wikstrom points out that the family is society's most important. The school is the most underused. The leisure sectors is the most overrated. Business society most contradictory. The criminal system most debated. The social service most diffused, and health service the most forgotten. In Denmark, 99% of our families is being visited by our healthcare professionals before the children turn to 1 year. So we have a lot of people visiting babies from 0 years and up. When I first heard about Wikstrom's theory, I thought that I had to educate my staff in this. But then I thought, no, I have been employed in the public sector for so many years, so that if I only educate my own staff, no one will listen and people will just wait for it to pass. Because of that, I started Who Conducts the Orchestra as an interdisciplinary education to professionalize the interdisciplinary collaboration. Instead of just organize the interdisciplinary work as we have done for years, we needed to be educated interdisciplinary and have the same prerequisites for collaboration with different disciplines and one set of rules for the dialogues in the interdisciplinary collaboration. I started by appointing a school and the interdisciplinary partners that are connected to the school. Since this number of interdisciplinary partners has gone to 130 people who have been educated in Who Conducts the Orchestra, which is a 17 days long education in Vejle. And you can look at this after the speech, if you like. This is the expert which are teaching on Who Conducts the Orchestra. Rune Kappel, who will be you will be hearing in a moment, Per-Olof Wikstrøm, who you have met at this conference, Marianne Grønbæk, who you will be meeting in a moment as well, and Dorte Hasholt, who is a cognitive psychologist, but she's not able to come today. And now I will like to welcome Rune to talk here.
All right, thank you. My first challenge is that I like to move around a lot when I'm speaking, but this has wheels, so I think I'm going to be able to. No, okay, you can see me besides the dog here. Awesome. My job in this project is to educate the staff in the staff that works in the municipality at where Helle lives. I'm actually a psychologist. I work daily in another municipality at Aarhus University. So I'm not even from the area where Helle is implementing this project. But she contacted me and asked me if I could help qualify and educate the staff who are working with the children to be able to understand and work with self-control so that they could develop the self-control with the children. And that's my angle on this topic. I'm a psychologist. I'm not a criminologist. I don't even know what I'm doing here right now. But I'm working normally within the field of clinical psychology and developmental psychology. And within that area, we also see that self-control is a really, really important area. It is one of the most studied fields within psychology. And as you heard before, it's really also important within the science of criminology. You heard Travis Hershey talk about how important self-control is. You heard Kathy Widom talk about how neglect can lead to a lot of bad factors who may make young people get involved in crime. And we also actually see when we study neglect scientifically that it correlates with self-control, so that if you have parents who neglect their children, the children are in danger of not developing a healthy portion of self-control. And you also heard, of course, Wikström, who is in the room right now, talk about how self-control can be important as a ability the children and the young have when they're faced with choices in their life that could lead into criminology. So I'm interested in the psychological interventions that can help children and teenagers develop their self-control, because it seems that it's really important. And now we have been talking a lot about self-control today. I think it's about time that we get a definition of it. It is our ability as humans to exercise restraint over our own impulses, thoughts, emotions, or desires. So this is, within the field of psychology, the thing that we think is the most important when it comes to a person regulating him or herself. Because in a lot of different aspects of our lives, we are faced with tempting choices and choices that could lead to bad decisions. And in all these situations, we need our intelligence to analyze the situation, but sometimes we also need self-control to be able to make the right decision on the long term. And here's what self-control looks like in action. This is from a modern remake of the marshmallow experiment. I would guess that most of you have heard about the marshmallow experiment, which is a very old experiment within the field of psychology. I'll tell you about it then. I saw some of you say no. The marshmallow experiment is cited as one of the most important studies within the field of psychology ever to have been conducted. And it's from 1961, I think. And Walter Mischel, who was leading this experiment, invited children in the age of 4 to 6 years old into his lab. And then he put the children in a room where there were a marshmallow, which is something that all children love. And there was a table and there was a chair. And then he said to the children, feel free to eat the marshmallow. That is perfectly okay. But I will just leave for a while. And if I come back and you have not eaten the marshmallow when I come back, you will get 2 instead of 1. And this is actually a symbol of self-control. What Walter Mischel is researching here is the children's ability to restrain themselves to get a bigger prize, because they will be able to restrain themselves. They are delaying their gratitude. So This is one of the most famous studies within the psychology, and what we see with these children is that in this age, 4 to 6, only 3 out of 10 is able to say no to this marshmallow. And you can see how painful it is for a child to sit alone in a room with a marshmallow and nothing else to do. An interesting thing about the marshmallow study is that Walter Mischel, he found a lot of these children when they became adults. And he found out that there were a lot of correlations between how good they were doing as children in the marshmallow experiment and how good they had been able to take care of themselves in a lot of big decisions for the rest of their lives, which affected their health, their wealth, their income, and also their ability to avoid substance abuse and crime. So we really think within the field of psychology that this self-control is so very, very important. Yes. As I said, it is widely accepted that childhood intelligence and self-control are the biggest predictors of physical health, wealth, substance dependence, criminal offending outcomes, and also family safety. It is stupid to make a very accurate pie graphic all these things, because of course it differs from individual to individual how important these factors are. But we actually think more or less within the clinical psychology that intelligence and self-control are have a correlation of 0.9 or 90% in combined in these different factors. Also things like how many traffic accidents will you experience through your life, we see correlates with intelligence and self-control. And self-control differs from intelligence here in one key factor, and that is because these two things, intelligence and self-control, they don't automatically follow each other. You can have a lot of individuals who have a lot of intelligence and low self-control, or the opposite, or high in both, or low in both. So it's not like they are linked. But we see that intelligence today we accept as being primarily inherited. But self-control is far less inherited. That means that we can do much more about influencing a child's portion of self-control, how much self-control they develop. In my humble opinion, I find a special group of young people interesting, who the prize winners have been, all of them, almost touching in the prize winner lectures. And that are these young people who actually have a good moral compass. They know what's right and wrong, but still fall from grace. Through their life, they get tempted to make some bad choices at some vulnerable moments in their life. Maybe the boy or girlfriend broke up, maybe they had a bad half year in school, maybe their parents are divorcing. And these young people who actually have a good moral compass are in a vulnerable situation. And in these situations, we see that their ability to make the right choice, even though they're vulnerable, that's their level of self-control. So there is a high risk, maybe, that these kids will try illegal substances or take part in small type of crime if their self-regulating skills, like self-control, are not appropriately developed. So, we widely accept that childhood self-control is a strong predictor for substance abuse and criminal activity later in life. And we also widely accept that self-control is something that actually can be trained. This is something that we can, with interventions, accelerate the development of, or improve the development of. So, we should really train self-control with our children. As Helle said before, the school is maybe one of the places where there is the most possibilities of actually doing more within to influence the development of these children. And my suggestion is actually that we will be able to, with psychological improvement interventions, be able to begin to train and exercise self-control and these other important executive functions that we see are so important for the children later to be able to make the right choices in their life. So my goal and also the assignment I've been handed from Helle is to, at this project who conducts the orchestra, to educate and qualify teachers and daycare employers and police and healthcare employers to develop a clear understanding of self-control. They need to know what this is, what this competence, what this ability actually is, and to be able to train self-control with these children and youth. And we actually, within the field of psychology, know a lot today about how to train this. This is something we can do right now. So, more or less, I wish to help put self-control on the school curriculum as part of this project, because that would hopefully mean that by helping these children in school and maybe also even in preschool develop their self-control, we should see that these children, when they become young and teenagers, are better able to make the right choices and, for example, avoid substance abuse and avoid crime. That, of course, means that you need schools that are okay with expanding their social responsibilities. But that's really another discussion. This is almost a political discussion. But I would say here that this is really a challenge because teachers teach. And this is something else. This is about improving the moral compass. It's about exercising and training and developing executive function. And that is something else than math or Danish or music lessons. And we need to be okay with that. But I think the prize here as a society would be really, really big if we accepted this as part of the school curriculum. Does this make sense to you at all? Yeah? Okay. Not falling asleep yet? Your self-control is maybe under pressure now because you've been listening to lectures all day. And one of the keystones in self-control theory is that it affects something called ego depletion in us. And that means that we have a limited resource of self-control that we use through the day. It's like a battery that runs out of power. So we also see these vulnerable times also can happen over a day. If you get tired, if you get exhausted mentally, you tend to make bad choices for yourself. We see it when you come home from the job where you had actually maybe planned before you went to job that you wanted to exercise, you wanted to do something about your home, but then when you come home, you're tired, your ego depletion is, your self-control is tired, and you're, because you have strained it all day, and then you can't make the right choices for yourself, and you end up on the sofa with your iPad. That's what I do anyway. Okay. A couple of examples on how to train self-control. This is something I, for example, try to work with making teachers be able to do in both the middle school and, actually in the whole school. So this exercise I call Winnow at the Time. And this is a one-on-one exercise. So you need the child in a one-on-one setting here. And what you do is you need something to play with. It has a pointer. This could be some bricks or Legos or dolls or cars you can play with, something like that. And you need something to count with and a timing device. And also a prize, because you will be putting the child under some strain here. And that means sometimes you have to motivate the child with a prize. And I'm okay with rewards. I think that's okay to use rewards to motivate children to try and work with themselves. I'm okay with that. Not all psychologists and teachers are okay with that. But what you do is actually more or less you put the child in a play situation where there is some rules. And every time the child breaks those rules, you take one of these counters away from the child. And then the child has to play with this within a time frame, for example, 10 minutes or 20 minutes or 30 minutes. And every time the child breaks one of the rules, you take one of these counters. So, for example, I typically start with 10 counters, so the child has, like, here I have an example where it's poker chips. They are great to count with. So I put 10 poker chips in front of the child, and every time the child breaks one of the rules I made, I take one of the poker chips. Those rules are, of course, designed so that to live up to the rules, the child has to use his or her self-control. I can explain this with a case. I had a 9-year-old child, a boy, who had really, really, really enormous ADHD. He was all over the place. He was really hyper. He was really had difficulties keeping his attention, keeping his focus, and he was diagnosed by the Danish psychiatry. So he was really a little boy who we saw had a lot of difficulties attending class because he couldn't sit still, and he went into a lot of conflicts because he was so hyperactive and his attention was all over the place all the time. So he loved to play with the Legos, you know, the Danish Legos, everyone knows Legos. And I put the rules for him was that he had to play with the Legos for 5 minutes, 5 minutes, that was all. And the rule was that I was sitting right in front of him at the table, and I was just sitting and reading, doing nothing. But every time he asked me something, I took one of the poker chips away from him. So every time he asked me something, he would get punished within the setting. And I swear to you, it only took 16 seconds into the exercise before he asked, "Is the 5 minutes done?" And then I took the first chip. And he had zero left when we were done with the exercise, and he was really, really frustrated. But we tried again the day after, and he was really motivated to do better, because he knew that if over the 10 times we would train this, if he collected 60 poker chips, that means he had to get at least 6 every time, he would get a prize. And the prize for this child was that he would be allowed to help the grown-ups, the adults at the school where he was, to cook 3 times. He loved to cook. So he would be allowed into the school kitchen and help the grown-ups to cook. I had made an agreement with the grown-ups about that, with the adults, with the teachers. So he was really motivated. And the day after, he did a little better. He kept 3 of the poker chips, and he was pretty good. He was pretty happy about that, but he knew he had to do better. And he, over these 10 times, progressed a lot and got a lot better at this. Actually, so much better. And I had warned him about this before the exercise, that maybe if he got too good at it, I would make it more difficult. So the last time I had him, he had to play with the Legos for 15 minutes. And he not only couldn't ask me anything, he couldn't even look at me. That was a new rule I implemented. So now it was really difficult. He had to stay focused on the Legos for 15 minutes and he couldn't even look at me. And I was sitting across a child who I observed several times do like this. And then refocused on the Legos. And that's a child who's beginning to feel his own self-control getting activated, and he's beginning to control his own self-control. And that's what we're after here. That's what we want to do. You remember the child from the marshmallow test? When you can get that expression in the faces of the children, you know you're doing it right when you're training self-control. So you can also train self-control with several children at once. I have been part of pretty many projects in Denmark. I was also part of a project in Denmark in a very in an area in the city where I'm living, Aarhus, where there is a lot of crime. It is a bad neighborhood, you would say. It is the ghetto of Aarhus. It's called Gellerup. Maybe you even heard about it, because it's pretty often in the news, because they go nuts out there. So I was being called out there to some schools who were working with bigger children. And it was they had an offer for the children in the area where they, after school, could come and be part of some different projects and different activities. Because we saw in that area that it was very important to include these teenagers in good activities after school, because that was typically where they were going out and making trouble. The problem was that one of the activities they were happy about doing in the summertime was playing football with these 15, 16, 17 year olds. And when they were playing football, it was often ending up with several of them getting hospitalized. And I mean that we had ambulances out there pretty often because they got in a fight. Their ego depletion was pressed, their self-control was low because they'd been in school the whole day. And then they went out on the soccer field and just went crazy. And that was a big problem. That's what made them call out to me and said, can you help us try and develop some skills for them to navigate through this activity so they can manage themselves, so they can self-regulate themselves. And one of the things we did was actually put different self-control exercises into the soccer matches. So for example, when I was playing soccer with them, I would make a signal and then everybody had to stand still for 2 minutes and do nothing. Just close their eyes and stand still for 2 minutes. And for boys and that teenagers in that age who are really tense because they are in the middle of a soccer match and they want to win and they want to run and they want to get the football, to just suddenly stand still and do nothing was a really, really hard exercise. They were more or less imploding on the spot. But after some time, we made them do it, and we made other exercises. For example, made systematic and controlled fights with them, where we were fighting with them. I was part of it with fighting equipment, so no one could get really hurt. But it was really tense fighting. We were really going to it. But every time I stamped on the floor like this, everybody had to sit down. So again, I trained the self-control in an exercise where they were really tense, and then they had to self-regulate them down, and then up and down and up, and slowly we saw that they became able to do this without us being there. The thing is here, you have to do it in a system, you have to make a system about it, and you have to also accept as an adult or as an the adult who is intervening that this is hard, this can lead to some frustration. But as long as the mall is there, and it was with these children in this ghetto, I saw these as good children. They were often really, really sad when things got wrong. They had a good moral compass. They wanted to do good, but they got in so many trouble because the self-control failed them. And when we have these children who actually wants to do good but can't do it, I would say that it is often self-control. We can see results from training. And that was my input. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Rune. Who conducts the orchestra? There is 2 days with Helle and Per-Olof Wikström, and then 1 day with Rune, 6 days with Anna Dorte, teaching. Okay. Yes. 6 days with Anne Dorte, and then 6 days with me, and then 2 days with exams. So it's a 17-day long education. And I would like here to thank Helle for really taking this seriously. A lot of times when I've been in things like this, it has been few days in and out. I think Helle has taken the full step, and she's doing it very seriously. Thank you, Helle. I'm Marianne Grønberg, and the reason why I'm here is that I developed semantic polarities together with David Campbell, Tavistock, London, and also I developed the growth model, and those two are models that we use in Who Conducts the Orchestra. It's so that I'm CEO and owner of MG Udvikling, and we do consulting, teaching, and training in public and private organizations. In HSO, as we call it, Who Conducts the Orchestra, Hvem Styrer Orkestret in Danish, my part is to be the last teacher before examination. So my part is to introduce and train the students in two dialogue models with which they can bring analyses into committed dialogues. You can also say I have to do the teaching in a way where I make the room for good dialogues in a practice that the students can use directly in their own practice as professionals. My goal is to go from disconnecting to connecting, and also to go from analysis to dialogues. I strongly believe that we people connect when we experience that we are an important part of our own future. And that is pretty much what we're doing at Who Conducts the Orchestra. How can we invite and engage people in their own transmission, changes, and so on. When I first started studying about the positioning theory together with David Campbell Tavistock, we were very much interested in all the positions that take place in the conversation, especially where the conversations were committed. So we were interested in committed conversations, and we came across Ford and Ford, who had been some research in uncommitted conversations and said that uncommitted conversations are about something and committed conversations are for something. And I think it's very important to look at the committed, because when I've been studying conversations, I've seen a lot of uncommitted conversations. It's easy for people to talk about something, but to talk for something is quite another position. Ford and Ford discovered that in committed conversation, one is willing to be held accountable for their speaking and its effects and impacts. And the same was for the listeners. And you can say both the speaker and listener are engaged and accountable for moving the action forward. We discovered the same thing when we were working with positioning. And you can say committed conversations are therefore conversations that create, direct, and forward the action of and for which the participants are accountable. And I think that's committing. So you can say, if we use positioning thinking and connect it with conversation, we can connect when we experience that we are an important part of our own future through conversation. Another thing that we take in Who Conducts the Orchestra, another point is that we say no person is the problem. And then we say the person is in the problem. And that means we are making a focus shift from here we have the person, the problem, to no, the person is not the problem. The person is in the middle of a problem, and all of us around this person are with the problem, and therefore you can say also a part of the problem. So,
sorry, try to stand behind it.
Okay.
It's easier for me.
Yeah.
Thank you, Marie.
Okay. So, in order to engage people in the process of change, we have to use conversation. And in that, I think, before we do that, and that's what we do in the Who Conducts the Orchestra, is that we have to engage people in the process of change through the conversation. And that means that we professionals have to make some changes. We do it in a way where we say to the students, you have to change your positions now. If what you're doing is not working, you have to change your position. And we use what we call a semantic polarity, something I developed together with David Campbell. And the line is a semantic polarity. So at both ends, you can put up, at one side, listening. At the other side, you can put up talking. And we use the first 3 days of my teaching to train this positioning with the students, so that it's not just something we talk about, it's actually something that they can do. But if you take this polarity line between listening and talking, it's actually possible for you to take different positions on this polarity line. And that's what we train. When we say, it's okay to take a position, but look, you can take other positions. And what consequences does it have that you take this position and not that position? There's a very clever woman called Astrid Lindgren from Sweden, who wrote a lot of books. And she said, when people with power stop listening to people, it's time to change them, to let them go and engage other people. And I think professionals are people with a lot of power. And I think for many years we've had so much power within the professional in all different situations with people. And I think it's time to let the people be within their own power. So we say at Who Conduct the Orchestra, we say, we professionals have the responsibility to create a room for a dialogue where everyone in the conversation can take a position and speak from it, be listened to, and take new positions. We know that if a person is not listened to in one position, it doesn't want to take another position. So if we just listen to the person in that position, it's willing to take another position. So therefore, we also say all the professionals that we teach, they have the responsibility to create a room for challenging conversation in a safe context. And this is how we do it. We use the growth model that I invented to create the dialogues. And as you can see, it's very simple. And normally when I make speeches, I call it the power of keeping it simple. Because I think we have to keep it simple in a way to be able to handle it. And it's just 5 circles. Altogether, it's a simple model. We start with successes as the first circle. And that means that in the first circle, we want to talk about everything we like, we do well, all that works. And when we first used it with small children, they said, oh, it's a sun, it warms you, because it was so nice and warm feelings they got from having all these nice saying about them. And many of the children and families we work with, they are not used to being said so many nice things about themselves. And they are not used to say anything nice to others. So the first circle is very important. Then we go to the next circle. Now I would like to point that that the first circle is both to look at all the behavior that works, that we can carry on, that we can do more of. And also it creates the motivation and energy to go on with the next circle. And the next circle is challenges. A lot of people in Denmark say, well, we don't have any problems anymore, we only have challenges. And when I go out into these organizations, I would say it's a lie. Because if you look at it and put challenges at one end of the polarity and problems at the other end, if you look at it, you can see that problems is something where we are looking back. We are looking back what happened, what was the problem. And challenges we use as something that we are looking forward. It's something when you look back and call the problem, you can always blame somebody for he did that, she did that. And if you look at the challenges, it's wishes, it's dreams, it's goals. Another consequence you can set up is that if you blame somebody, that somebody will have a natural need of defending itself. With challenges, we discover people are working with us. And I just put disconnect and connect up as well. So going back to challenges, it seems as if all people who are just using the word of we don't have problems, we only have challenges, but they in a way didn't mean it. They still were talking about problems. So here we try to make the focus shift. And with challenges, we are talking about all the wishes, all the dreams. What are your wishes? What are your dreams? What are your goals? And it's not just the young person or the family, it's everybody. So in this model, we engage everybody in the conversation. From there, we go to the third circle of possibilities. And the possibility is connected with the challenges. So what possibilities? If we want this dream, this wish, this goal to come true, what can we do? What can everybody? And everybody can contribute to this circle and can give good examples and come up with good creative possibilities. And then from there on, we go to agreements. Agreements is something that everybody in the conversation, everybody, we don't ever have any free seats when we have these conversations. Everybody. We don't have any consultants sitting there just to give advice. Everybody is engaged in this conversation. And all the agreements is something that you have to take at least one possibility and say, this I will do. Everybody, at least one. You can take all you want, but you have to take at least one. And when everybody does that, we know we'll succeed in the changing. Then there's a fifth circle. And to begin with, we didn't thought it was a part of the growth model. But we discovered that using that at the end, we found out what is working in this particular conversation, this particular situation, on the one hand. On the other hand, we found out that it was very important for us to let people out of the room with the best thought, because they were then motivated to go back and they were going out and actually do something about this, because they signed up for different agreements. So, In the growth model, very simple said, you can say the growth model can be compared to an agenda. Each circle is a topic where everyone's inputs are written down. I won't go into details here further with the growth model, but it's we use flip chart, we use different kind of colors for the pens, and each person has its own color. So that each person has its own voice. And in that way, you can see clearly on the flip chart if it's only the professionals who are talking, and where is the young person, where is the family, what do you want to say? So we use the visuality. So you can say the dialogue model is based on systemic thinking, positioning theory, Perceptual Inquiry, Luhmann Theory, and Hal Koch, a Dane who made up some rules for conversation. It's very simple to use once you have learned it, trained it, and learned to handle the complexity in dialogues. And that's why we have them 6 days learning both positioning and also the growth model. It's visualized all through the conversation, through a writing process on the flip chart. And that's another point we discovered, that when people have to write, they tend to just write one word. And then we say, well, can you write a whole sentence? And if they do that, they also, the professionals, tend to go down on the amount of sentences. And it's more clear what we all talked about. And through the process, everybody can see what was said, what was this person's statement, what was this person's statement. The thing is that the growth model offers a method for dialogues where all participants in the conversation can and will take their positions in a clear and powerful way without getting mixed up in their different positions. So a mother can be a mother and take the mother position. A child can take the child position. A father can take the father position. Policeman can take the policeman position. And we discovered that before we used the growth model, they often thought, oh, if just the policeman would do something else, and if he will just change, if just the child would do something else, if just everybody else and me will do something else, I'll succeed. So the growth model, in the way that we use it, takes it back. So what will you do? What will you do? What will you do? You can say that it also creates very active conversations. Often we are standing up and writing, and people say to me, yeah, but what do I do if people can't write? I just ask them to write. If not, I can write. What do you do if people can't see? Well, they often cope in other different ways. If they can't hear, what about children? There's something about children. We don't use the whole growth model with small children. We only use the first model, the first circle, because it's too complex to understand the rest. But it's very active conversations that we have. We have some sayings from who conducts the orchestra when we said, what is the growth model? And what does it give? And they said it gives success in connecting and in the process of changing through the structured dialogue. And they said it has a fantastic way of creating a space of creativity and preciseness that helps the process of change through shifting the focus from the problematic to the best solutions. And it looks simple. It is simple. You just have to learn it and to learn to be in the dialogue. Yes. Thank you.
The work done with grading crime prevention in Violet today is built on who conducts the orchestra. That means that all of our crime prevention meeting with young people, parents, partners, is based up on an analysis of the young individuals under Wikström's series. Hereafter, an effort is started based on the specific knowledge about self-control and cognitive psychologies that is available to us through Marianne Grønbæk's series and methods. So we use it in all our meetings with preventing crime for young people. Oh, it's very awful here. So who conducts the orchestra in the family, in the school, in the minister, in the crime prevention effort? We ask every time, who conducts the orchestra? I make a book, as you can see here afterwards, about this project. It's in the Danish, sorry, but I'm best there, to tell other people about this project. Springer lige den over. Okay. Vil du sige det?
Yeah. And we now have time for questions. Could we just ask you to reflect on what has been the best, the most inspiring, the most challenging you have just heard?
Thank you for an interesting lecture. I think the best thing for me was this growth model, because I work as a police community police officer in Sweden, and we are currently undergoing community dialogues with the external partners and with the people who live in the community, and we're asking them on what we can do better in the crime prevention area. And we have a certain areas in the community that are so-called bad neighborhoods with low connections between people who live there in the society. And I think that this growth model can be a good thing for me to gather all the people that live there and shift the focus from the problems to challenges in changing the area together. And who can do what, because we, the police, can't do everything. We all have to work together. And I will try to use this growth model with that. So that was nice. And the most challenging thing was about the self-control thing. I totally agree on everything. I found it really interesting. The one thing that came in mind to me was, is there a conflict between the free choice and the society's effort to try to make people have self-control? Can you understand the thinking I have? It's not that I disagree with you at all. I'm just interested in if the schools would apply this in their schedules and stuff, that it could be a conflict on the society telling children what to do, rather than this is an instrument on how to deal with a thing in a good way. That's my, it's not really a question, it's just a thought I had, if you could understand it.
I just want to make a comment to your question. I mean, I think that kind of question, that's what we do anyway. You have laws. Laws is telling people what to do and not to do. That's the basic. The school, you have rules to schools and so on. So there's no qualitative differently to introduce, let's say, morality, self-control, physical training. I mean, the people say that we have a problem with obesity, we need to have physical training. It's basically the same. So I don't think that is the problem. So the question if it's a problem with that actual kind of specific activities, rather than as a principle to ask people. I'm sorry, you should answer this.
Yeah, I have, of course, a comment too. The thing is that it's a difficult term to grasp, this self-control thing, but we see, and that's my angle on it, that people who develop a healthy portion of self-control make better choices for themselves that makes themselves happy. Self-control actually correlates with happiness, whatever that is. But that would be my angle on it. That would be helping young people and children develop the skill to make choices for themselves that they are happy with. And I think that's the right angle on self-control. Of course, it could be used. It could be used in an unhealthy way if you, for example, began to mix up moral and norms and self-control. And that's really dangerous territory. That's also why I think that both Vikram and Travis at the Prize Lectures, Prize Winners Lecture, they are very keen on splitting those two up. Moral and norms and self-control are really two different things.
I think that's what I was aiming for.
Yeah.
It's because it's a thin line between
it is.
Those two things. So that's.
And I really agree on that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good reflection.
Thank you.
For me, a really inspiring thing about hearing you guys talking is that I work with Professor Wikström on this research, and it's really, really great to see that our work is being taken out by practitioners into the field and actually doing something, because as academics, we can sit and do all of this research, but it kind of gives meaning to what we do if actually it has an impact. So that's really inspiring for me to see that, and it's really encouraging, and it, as I say, gives meaning to what we do. The thing that is challenging for me is, and I think I saw it on a slide, sorry I was late, but I saw it on a slide that you had how it works, which is what we do in our research. And then the next question is what works. So when you do your work, I am really interested as an academic and a researcher to understand what the impact of your work is. So do you have ways of measuring either the baseline and then before and after, or particularly I was thinking of the self-control, I was thinking the training works, but how long does it work for? And also, what is the impact of that? Does it change behavior outside of the game setting or the football field setting, or and the training that you do, what are the impacts of that and how we might see them actually changing behavior in the long term, which is what we're all aiming for.
I was very happy when, Carl, you introduced us as pioneers. I think Hele, every time she established this education with about 30 people, she established a camp of pioneers. And I think that's one of the things that we are very good at. We maybe would have some benefit of inviting some researchers to do some work now. That would be very nice if you... We could go on with our collaboration here. And we have stories. We have stories all the time. As soon as, you know, I come in at the end, but at that time, when I start with teaching, how can they connect? How can they create the dialogue room? And they start using all what they've been taught also in their own practice. And then they tell stories about it. And one came and last time she started, when I came as a teacher, she didn't show up the first day, her child was sick, and of course she wants to stay home the next day because, you know, the mother heart and everything, and the child was still sick and so on. And Hele has made it very, very clear that if you want to have your degree, you have to be here. And so she came the next day, and if you can say, she came in backwards, and she was angry. Very angry. And she sat down, and all that we've talked about the day before, she was not very interested. She had other models, she had other things, other behavior that worked for her, and so on. And, you know, that was just a position. So we went on the second day, and then they go home and they work with all what we have been taught, teaching them. And came back 2 weeks later, and then we started out with what have you been doing good things since last? And we came to her, and I thought, okay, because she went out of the door the second day also with her back turned to us, and she said, well, I experienced that we had this child, a young boy. And he has been up at different kind of meetings all over, in kindergarten and in school and so on. And it was not very good stories. So they decided they had to have a new meeting. And then she said, well, can we use the growth model now? And then before they should meet, they invited another consultant, and this consultant said, I don't know the child, so I'll just spend two hours with this child. And then they came to the meeting, and this consultant said, well, if we start with the first circle, I can tell another story. The first story about this child was that he was never sitting down. He was disturbing all the teaching and all the time at school. And everybody got tired, and the teacher said, we cannot cope with this child. And now came another story that actually this consultant had seen that this child was very interested in other people. He was very social. So every time he got up of the chair, he wanted to go and see, he could at once see, you don't know what we are doing right now, you need my help. And he would go and help, and you need my help, and you need my help. And that was another story of this boy. So going from he was a big problem till he was a very helpful person. And that created another room, and especially for the parents and the boy. So they started some changes that they had never thought could be there. So we have a lot of, I could keep on telling you stories, but we need to do some more research about it.
Yes. Actually, if I can give you a comment too, because I'm also an academic. This is not my job. I'm working at the university in Aarhus. And this would require almost a couple of PhDs to evaluate scientifically a project like this. But I think it would be worth it, because we're talking about something that we are fiddling with some of the groundworks in the society here, which I think is what we need to do if we need to take an area like this seriously. For me personally, I can say that the methods I apply, because I'm living in a mix between having within my job both the academic side, I do some research, but I also do a lot of interventions. And I try to implement interventions and teach other interventions that already are scientifically and empirically proven to have some effect on self-control. But I know that it is in other contexts, it would definitely be healthy to check it out in this context too. So I agree with it. Scientifically, evaluation would be awesome.
Actually, I come to think of it, Hele asked them the question, does this have an impact, not on the students, but on their work, those they work with? And she has a lot of examples on that.
And I'm sorry, I'm not that good at English, so I have a little help here. But I'm very glad as a practic. I work only with the young people, and I'm not academic, but I'm very happy to learn Wikström and make this against Wikström and other experts, because I can't do it myself. I could do any lot of other stuff, so we need each other. It's very important, so we can help each other to understand what's going on and how did we do it. But when I finish this book, Minister of Justice. They asked me to come to a meeting, and after that they come to Vejle, and we have a whole day talking about this, and they took it back to the minister and discuss it. And in August they went back and make something about this. And since we began Who Conducts the Orchestra, the police have chosen to send leaders to do a master degree in Cambridge, and furthermore the police academy had launched a degree that is built upon Wikström's theory, which I will be teaching in. So a lot of people are very interested in this theory, and it makes sense in Denmark, so it longsomely growing. So, and therefore Wikström, you have to come up here. Yes, please. Yes, please.
Can I just say one thing to conclude the session? And that is the kind of work you do. It's fantastic. Actually, during my career, worked a lot, as you know, with different local projects, and have another project. For a project to work, and so on. You always need someone. I don't know how you translate eldsjäl. How do you translate that? Anyone Swedish who know how one does that? But someone who is extremely dedicated and so on. And every time it has worked, when I've been involved, I have been approached. Because if I approach someone, it never works. So for some reason, I don't know why. So we've done a few projects, and since this is type, I will mention no names, but we've done a few projects in Sweden with equally amazing people. But the problem in the Swedish project is that these people, when it works well, they have been promoted. Yeah. and then it collapses. So in a sense, I was thinking, how can one actually reward people, sort of, because it's a crucial post to do this, and then if you sort of promote people to a more desk job or higher up and so on. So I'm just saying to them, and I think it's a really interesting problem, the transferation of what we do, how you actually transfer it into practice, which people nowadays call translation and criminology and so on. But I concur with the others, looks to be a very amazing job you do. So,
thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So,
and Hope, stay here, please, because I will also congratulate you with the prize winner here today, and therefore I have made a little present for you, I would like you to open it, to show it here. It. Yes, please.
Oh gosh.
Do you like this chocolate?
I don't think so.
I'm not.
Well, it's like Christmas.
Yes.
Oh, I can see what it is.
I don't know what you call it, but it's to conduct.
I think this is really, you should have this one, but it's very nice.
It's Dr. Train.
Please tell the people what it is, because I don't know the name.
It's what is it called in English? Baton.
The battle. So now you can battle the crime prevention.
Excellent.
For me.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for all your help.
Thank you, everyone. Okay.
Thank you.
It's really nice.
I think there are some more questions.
Hi, I found the whole thing kind of inspiring and challenging, particularly sort of the discussion about whether schools should widen their remit of what they're there to do more than teaching maths and English. I had a specific question about self-control, and I've done some research and I've worked in schools, and a lot of school policy seems to aim at restricting and removing the provocations and the motivations and the temptations to act against or break school rules. I can think of a silly example was that one of the schools I worked in had a problem where pupils were not tying their ties properly, so the solution was to change to clip-on ties. In the short term, that was great because this type of problem behaviour stopped, there was less conflict between teachers and pupils. But in the long term, do you think that would have consequences on the ability to exercise self-control if the opportunities to exercise self-control were removed?
That's an interesting question. I don't know. I think what they're trying to, I guess you're from England,
yeah.
Where you have school uniforms. That's part of the tradition there. So you have some norms and some moral that gets symbolized with the school uniform. And that, I would say, is something else than self-control. But to wear maybe the emotional impact of wearing a school uniform and to maybe have difficulties tying your, what do you call it?
Tie.
The tie, probably. That would maybe require some self-control from the children. So maybe you're saving the children's self-control by loosening the restrictions, but that also means maybe that you're loosening your norms and your morals. But that's me guessing from here. What I'm trying to do when I'm training self-control is creating setups where it doesn't get mixed in with other stuff too much. So I wouldn't make an self-control exercise be part of the normal teachings or their homework. I would try to make it something separately, because otherwise the children mix it together, and we need to make them able to separate these things so that they know and they feel when they are using the self-control, because we see that when children and young people and teenagers get a feel for when and when they are not using the self-control, they're beginning to navigate with it. They're using it as a competence, they're using it as a skill. And that's what we want to do at the same time as we want to train it and make it stronger. So I think it's important to try to split it up.
Thank you.
Was that an okay answer?
There's a funny thing that I thought of, and that is that we also train the professionals' self-control.
Yeah.
Because when they start, they want to give good advice all the time. Do that, do that. And the thing about good advice is that they are only best for those who give them. So what we train them, and also use the thoughts of self-control, is to, instead of give good advice, instead of take the talking position, they have to take the question position and ask questions instead. And I think in that way, and that's what's great about what Helle has created, is that the whole education is based on these ideas. And we have to use them in our teaching. And I think that means that the students will come through the same process, that when they go out and use this, they are more fit to use the process because they've been through it by the teaching. So
there are some research that shows that Danish teachers only listen for a few seconds to the children before they interrupt them. And to break that bad habit and actually begin to listen or ask questions in another way, I would say would require self-control for a period of time until you make it a rhythm, a routine. Yeah.
Thank you very much for your attention and your great questions. Give our speakers another round of applause.